This Manim tutorial is going to be about probability simulators, like the ones you're seeing on the screen. Now, if you found any of these tutorials helpful, make sure you hit the subscribe button so you're not going to miss out the other upcoming Manim tutorials. Getting into the code of this first example here, I'm going to, whenever I'm running some probability simulators, I'm going to utilize the random feature within Python. So I'm just going to import that initially. Now, this stuff here is for my SVG files and image files. I don't know how you're going to access them from your directory in your PC, but this is how it does it from mine. So if you're struggling with that, I'll leave a link in the description below with a video explaining how to do that for your computer. So going through this animation where the numbers are randomizing and then we're just putting a box around them, this is how we want to program it out. We've got a bunch of numbers, which is a vector group. We create a for loop so that we can get 28 of those numbers. They're decimal numbers. This defaults to two decimal places. You can change that if you wish. So we go through this for loop. It's going to do it 28 times. We've got a number, which is a decimal number, and we add that to the vector group. I create a randomizing numbers function where what's going to be happening is it's going to access numbers as an input. So we go for num in numbers, where this numbers is the inputted one that we put into the function. And we're going to do this as a for loop. So it's for all the numbers that are in numbers. We've got a value that goes between 0 to 1. So we've got, it's random.uniform. So it's a random number between 0 and 1. And it's going to be a decimal number. So for example, you could get 0.01. Or you could get 0.5382. Don't know. It's just going to be a random number between 0 and 1. So now you can include this conditional. If the value is greater than 0.1, it's green. So 90% of the time it's green. Otherwise, it's red. So that's that 10%. And so this is how you might want to explain binomials like this. And then in our code, we're going to be randomizing our numbers there. We want to set a width to them. Now, this is fairly arbitrary, this 0.38. It's just so on my Manim screen, imagine that's it there. I've just got my list of numbers fits nicely rather than having the numbers go over the edge of the screen so you can't actually see them. So the number's fairly arbitrary. I'm arranging them to the right. So we're going to go 1 all the way through to 28 and then putting them to the edge. Now I'm going to create a function where I am getting the results. So this is again accessing the numbers, which is sort of like the data in our case. So we've got results is a vector group, where I'm going to do this as a for loop. So it's for num in numbers, where this numbers is accessed from the input of the function. So it can be whatever. It's sort of like for the number in your data, if that's a way you want to think about it. We've got if the number is greater than 0.1, we're going to give a result, which is a mobject. It's an SVG mobject. It is a green tick. I'll make sure I set the color to green just in case anything goes wrong. And I set a width to that tick. Now, this is just illustrating that 90% of the time, I'm going to be correct. 10% of the time, so else, return a red cross. Put the result next to the number, down from it with a small buff, and we add that to the results vector group. We do that as a for loop, so it does it again and again and again for however many numbers are in this group, and then we return the results. And really here, what we're doing is we're just replaying this 10 times. So I've got randomizing numbers, so update from func. Really, this, to be honest, I have read through the 3 blue 1 brown code and done a little bit of pinching for how he's syntaxed it out, but that's what he's done there to give that randomizing effect. I wait, I access the results, which is getting the results. So from my get results function that I've created, get the results of the numbers that I've made, which is the 28 decimal numbers. Write the result, box around the results, create the box, fade out the box, fade out the result. Do that 10 times. So it'll do that, and then everything resets. And then it'll do it again, and again, and again, 10 times. And then we are done. Now getting into an animation that's a little more interesting than that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a little helper function, which is really to help me get the data that you're going to see in the top left hand corner, which is all the ticks and crosses. So I've just got this W, which is the width of each object. And what I'm doing here is I've got a tick row. So there's two of them, where if you read it through, it's a vector group where I'm creating a loop. So I've got to have that asterisk there. And I'm accessing the vector group. This is the syntax I use on my computer. And I'm going to be creating 10 of those, where I'm setting the width to what I've initially got there. So this is going to have tick, tick, tick. Okay, 10 of them. I'm arranging them to the right and I'm putting them to the up left part of the screen. And then you can see I've got it again for this one here, except this time, instead of going to edge, I'm going to put it next to what I've just got before. So I'm going to have another 10 down from what I've got. Now, this is all within the get data part. I've got a row of crosses. Very similar. It's a vector group. Got that star because I'm creating a loop of them. I'm creating 10 and I'm putting them underneath. So next to this row here and down. So I'm going to have cross, cross. Okay. And you can see I do that another time and one more time. So I've got 50 things there. We can see at the end, I've got a result, which is a vector group of the row one, row two, and then the cross rows. And I've got a star in front of them because those are not individual mobjects. They are vector groups themselves, which create multiple mobjects. I've got to put that star around them there, and I want to return the result. So this is sort of just like a helper function. So when I go get data one, this is going to access all of that stuff that I've created. Now, if you're trying to illustrate out the central limit theorem, for example, I'm just going to make sure I am accessing my data. So data is equal to that, and I'm inheriting it from the self. I create an axis. I've got my axis there. I give it a label, p hat, because I'm trying to illustrate central limit theorem. And I'm going to put some decimal numbers down. Now, this isn't built in yet, but I asked some people in the Discord, and I got a pretty rapid answer as to how I would put decimal numbers on my axis. So I just wanted 0.1, 0.2, all the way through to 1. Okay, and somebody geniusly responded with this syntax here. Why does it work? I have no idea, but they were really helpful and they got it to work. So that's always great. Okay, after that, what I'm creating is some words to put on the screen. So I've got total samples, sum of averages, and then the average sample proportion count. So those are just text and I'm just positioning them. So I'm scaling them and positioning them where I want them on the screen. So I've got that text initially sat there. Then I add all of that to my scene. Now I'm going to be pulling out samples of 10, which means that there is 11 possible outcomes, because you could get 0 out of 10, 1 out of 10, 2 out of 10, all the way through to 10 out of 10 corrects. And what we're going to have is a counter number, so I can keep a count of how many samples I've gone through, and I need to create a mobject if I want that to be on the screen. And I'm going to update that mobject, so I'm just going to add a number where the counter number is an integer, which is always going to be the value of that there. So if I add to it, my mobject will update. Very similar thing with the sums, very similar thing with the average p hat value. So this is the sum of the p hats. This is the average p hat. And again, you'll notice, add the updater, add that stuff to the screen. Now what I'm doing here is with this sums, this is such that it stacks in my histogram properly, where I've got sums equal to an array of 0 times by the possible outcomes. So I'm going to have, there's going to be 0 corrects, or I could get 1 correct or 2 or 3, all the way up to 10 out of 10 corrects. Okay, from my sample of 10. Now this is really where all of the stuff is happening. It's happening within a for loop. So for S in range of 15. So we're gonna go through this 15 times. So the very first time we're gonna go through it. So this is all happening once, and then we're gonna repeat it 15 times. Now again, I'm calling on this random function within Python, and it's a random sample. So A, that's what I'm calling that. A is gonna be a sample of, and my sample count is 10, where the numbers range from 0 to 50. So for example, I could pick out the number 3, I could pick out the number 11, I could pick out the number 2, and I could pick out the number 8. So this is what A would be equal to. It would be equal to that sample of stuff that I've picked out. I want to create a sample of results. That's a vector group. I'm going to initialize that, same as the boxes. Now, a little bit of Python logic. So this is like a loop within a loop, but really I just want to loop through this sample here. So I go for I and result in enumerate. Now what enumerate's going to do is it's going to create an array that kind of matches each of these. So I will be this term here in A, one, the first, the second, and the third. Okay, so we've got the result, which is the data A of I. So the result here with this res here is going to access from the data the ith element, where the ith element is given by that enumerate function. We want to put a box around it and we want to add it to the sample results. Also add the box to the box of vector group, other vector grouped boxes. And I want to go through and do that for all of the elements in A. So it's going to rectangle, rectangle, rectangle. And those are the results that I have got. Now this data here, remember data is the mobject. So that's going to be the tick or cross that it's accessing there. So there's going to be a whole bunch of ticks and crosses, and it is putting a square around those. What I'm then going to do is make a copy of it because I want to move it away, but I want the data to stay there. So we're going to create the boxes, and then the moved result, which is the copied one there, we animate it, we arrange it to the right, and we put it to the edge up. So kind of put it to the top of the screen, while at the same time fading out the boxes. So it kind of gives away that effect that the data is now back to how it should be. Again, putting another loop within a loop. Now I'm just going to go through the same example that I had here. So let's say my A is, again, 3, 11. So we're going to go through, we're going to enumerate these. So again, enumerate is creating I such that I can put an array for each of these elements, where if the value, and the value comes from the stuff in A, if it's less than 20, then it's going to be worth 1. And that's because the first 20 elements that I'm selecting from are all ticks. Okay, so I've got the 0th all the way through to the 19th mobject. So those I know would be a tick, so I'm going to assign the value of 1. Otherwise, I assign it a value of 0. So it'll go through here and it'll check, is this number less than 20? If yes, add 1. If not, don't add 1. And it'll go through and it'll do it for all of the elements that I've got there. We want to create a proportion, which is going to be a decimal number. So that's going to be the value of our p hat as a mobject. I want to then show the sum of A. So the total is going to be the sum of A, which is the sum given by this enumerate function here. Then we're going to set the value to the total divided by the sample. So the total might be, you get, I don't know, 6, and then the sample is out of 10. Okay, so that's your p hat value, right? Which would go to 0.6, for example. Put it next to the move result and to the right of it. This is where it's all stacking in the axis. So we've got the axis box, surrounding rectangle. So you're gonna have your results here. So it might be tick, tick, oh, let me color code it. Tick, 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 cross, cross, tick, for example. And we're going to create a rectangle around all that with these customizations. And then I want to stack it in. So I'm going to have the vector group of the move results and the box that I've just created. Draw the box, write the proportion, add one to the sample counter, keep a track of the total sum and the averages. So this is going to constantly update this stuff here with what we initialized all the way up here for these numbers that we set there. So that's keeping a track of those. Self-play. So we're finally getting to the playing part of it. Stack in axis, which is that vector group of stuff we've got. Animate next to and put it to the axis number. So within the axis, it's gonna reach that axis number. If it's a p hat of 0.1, put it next to that number and up from it. Okay, set a width. Again, this is fairly arbitrary. So it can be a box, for example, that fits in within there. And then shift it up by the sums total. So this sums total is gonna be, for example, if you got a p hat value of 0.6, it is so whenever I put the next box down, it's not going to shift up. So I don't have something that looks like this. Okay, I'm gonna have something that stacks on top of each other. And I'm going to add the value so that when I'm shifting it up, I'm gonna add the value of the stacking axis get height. And we're gonna do that for every single time we wanna take a sample. So that was just for one sample. Then this loop is gonna go through it. So that was for one. It's gonna do that 15 times. This is the nice programmatic part. Once you've got it set up and working for one, it's just gonna go through it again and again and again. And if you wanna do multiple of these, every time you have a self-play, you can change it to a self-add. So it saves the rendering and the runtime, or you can just put comma runtime equals 0.1.